Where's your HD?
I didn't bring it. I
don't know, really?
Yeah.
Why not?
Because I wanted to get this one.
I don't know.
I figured you guys would all bring your HDs.
And yeah, then we have multiple angles of HD. Okay,
whatever.
Did you ask me to bring my HD?
No, I assumed you would.
Ah, there's that assumption thing.
Well, I mean, I think it's a reasonable assumption.
Have your attention, please. No, really. Stop what you're doing right now and listen to what I have to say. Today's performance by MirthCon is sponsored in part by MirthCon. MirthCon, the science experiment that went horribly right.
Portions of this program have been fully subsidized in part or in full fully by the state of California.
Hi there. Thank you, CalProg people. I'd like to talk to you now about Carolyn. Carolyn is the only native Californian in MirthCon. And being that this is CalProg and that we want to honor that individuality, we have put together a little program for you. So without further ado.
California, a history. A student's guide to the history of California with Bert Gravel. Hear what Bert has to say about California history. Tonight, on the State of California's presentation of California, a history. A student's guide to the history of California with Bert Gravel. California, a history.
Welcome to California.
Thank you. I know, for like this myself.
Welcome to California. I'm your host, Bert Revell. And I'm here today to take you on a magical journey. A journey that begins with you. And of course, our beautiful state of California. Now friends, when the universe was in the initial stages of its creation, California was way off the map, if you know what I mean. But soon enough, it was formed, along with lots of other geologic and scientific phenomena. We might think that California was always here, but it wasn't.
Is it's an idea.
Yeah, what's the idea behind it?
I think it's a small animal.
Well, I'm not entirely sure.
Is it a brand of wheat cereal?
It's kind of weird.
I thought it was a band.
Murkcon is my favorite band.
I think I know someone who plays in it.
I get to play in it, and it's some of the best music I've ever heard.
They're kind of crazy. They play a lot of weird-ass shit.
It's a multimedia event.
It's a band.
Rock band?
It's a band. It's a band. They play weird shit. I like it. A lot of notes in a very particular order.
It stemmed from an activity that me and my friends used to do in high school. We would get stoned and we would rap in alien languages. Juxtiflevdorn. Phonicon, Decaron, Denifot, Bepsilio Fuega, Mirthcon, Rectoban,
was a phrase. So I wrote a piece once called it MirthCon, and then made a CD and called it MirthCon, and it just kind of stuck. Mirth, as we know, is, you know, joy or merriment or entertainment, and con, to deceive or, you know, to con someone. That's what MirthCon is. It's an entertaining con. It's an entertaining deception. It's using entertainment to lie, or it's using lies to entertain.
Why are there two guitars in MirthCon?
Wally's not good enough to play all the parts.
It's true. It's true.
Well, it's true. Wally is not good enough to play those parts. But I am.
And who are you?
I'm Travis Andrews.
I'm Travis.
Yeah.
How does it feel being the new guy?
It's okay. I haven't been hazed yet. Not that I've minded, but it just hasn't happened yet.
Yeah.
Really? It's subliminal hazing.
Yeah.
This is part of it. I'm also the baby. Kind of feels like getting called up to the big leagues. I feel like Sandra Day O'Connor. I think that was also part of the audition process, was how much do you physically resemble Rob? Are you going to fade in, or are you going to do a star wipe?
This next song was written by our bass player, Matt Lebofsky. Hey, Matt.
Oh, hey.
Oh, is there anything you'd like to tell these fine people about your composition?
Oh, yeah, sure. This song called Cascades.
Great. Okay, great. Cool. Can you count it off?
All right, one, two, three, four.
We might think that California was always here, but it wasn't.
Before life arose in the universe, all objects, concepts, actions, feelings, and intentions congregated in the vast expanse of untamed information. Intelligence arose with its finely articulated mapping, separating each component from every other, and recording the connections among them. It was this intelligence alone that would bear witness to the first recitation of the ancient story of the naming of the earth and the moon and the sun.
If being is sort of the essential truth or core of one's life, everybody, I think, is a being and a non-being at the same time. If there was no non-beings, then everything would just be. And that doesn't make any sense to me.
I don't think it's ethical to eat a shark fin suit. So, I don't know. I think you're probably hearing a lot of them sound bites going around, and they're just taking everything out of context, and I don't know. I ate it.
There's no plan, there's nothing, there's just, it's Brownian motion, man. We're all just bouncing along and bouncing off of each other and apologizing if we hit somebody too hard, hopefully. But the big master plan, who's in charge? Nah.
There's just a lot of weird shit that goes on in Disneyland that I'm convinced of. And, I mean, that's been pretty documented, like that weird room with all the alcohol in it, and it's never quite clear what happens there. You have to be a really rich politician or somebody in the know, and then you get to go to that VIP creepy little room in Disneyland that no one knew was there, and there's tunnels underneath it, and yeah, it's very sinister.
Mayans, you know, they were pretty savvy people who just knew how to work with what they got. Crop circles, people can do those in a couple hours. It's really not a big deal. One guy shot JFK. He got a gun, he shot him. Case closed.
Oh, the lone gunman. That's just like, what?
I'm not sure that I agree with that. I don't know.
Have you read anything about that?
I was there. I saw it. Okay? Shit! I just put two and two together, you know? I mean, do the math.
You know, in politics, like, all Republicans are evil, and, you know, all Democrats are hippie liberals or whatever.
I had the power of God mixed with the power of my truck.
You know, the whole MirthCon mythology...
The doctrine.
I know everything is revealed.
I mean, it's sort of all interwoven. It's what the music is. It wouldn't be this music without this sort of mythology. It's not like it's all absolute music. It's very... What's the word for that? It's programmatic. It's telling a story. I mean, it's all part of the story that this music is telling.
We're actually, humans are like a virus from outer space. You know, we didn't really originate from Earth. We've been planted here from some intelligent species somewhere else, and this whole thing is one big experiment.
That's the whole mythology that MirthCon is shrouded in. You know, even as a member of the band, it's slowly being revealed to me. I know, just little bits and pieces have been revealed to me, the whole idea that there's this deity that oversees everything, and it's not necessarily a benign deity. It seems to be this sort of sinister but very detached way of observing what's going on. You know, like there are certain prophets that are sent here on Earth by the deity to try to influence what's going on. And, I don't know. When work gets out, it's going to be like you're saying, the walls are going to fall down.
We explore an intriguingly radical new theory, delving into the deepest, darkest origins of an until recently obscure folktale emerging from the depths of the Louisiana Bayou. For centuries, local woodsmen have spun fanciful yarns of this shadowy figure, as dashing as he is crude, equal parts Errol Flynn and Boris Karloff. A man consigned, for whatever reason, to wander the swamps in search of a destiny whose particulars remain forever shrouded by the mists of time. On the other hand, a narrative more modern in origin. Men and women of science increasingly agree that we humans may indeed be the result of panspermia, that the seeds of life may have arrived here on Earth from the furthest reaches of our galaxy. Could these two accounts be linked? Could the truth lie somewhere in the intersection of the two? Might their frightening implications consequently reach further and deeper than previously thought, even into our own time, with their frighteningly consequential implications? What follows is a dramatization of these events as they may have actually happened. We leave the drawing of conclusions up to you. We'll be right back.
it's written on your shirt. Oh, you can read and write.
Let's not fight.
Let's not cross my mind.
That's good because aggression ain't the way to go.
Well, it's funny you should mention that because I am an expert.
Well, then you must be an expert on aggression. And you are commonly known as Biggie Doggo.
Well, that is not my name. You really should just call me Cleroy.
Well, I'll be goddamn.
What? I don't know.
You have no idea what any of this has to do with you.
Well, I really must say that I can't exactly say how I just got here.
Let me tell you how.
I don't want to know.
I need to know.
No, I don't want to know. I don't need to know.
And you'll never understand. But I'm supposed to tell you all about your present and your future and your past.
I don't want to hear anything about it now.
Uncle Baljo, you really should just listen to what I have to say.
You want
to
see? Expect me to listen to a dog.
The human.
We've argued a point, and I'm not sure what it was.
I'd have to agree.
We'll be right back.
expect you, the audience, to participate in the show that we've got going up here. If you've been paying attention, you notice by now that this is a song about bees. And as we all know, bees live in hives and have a hive mind. So here's what we're going to do. We need you, the audience, to join us, the band, and meld minds so that we can all sing together. Jared's going to display the lyrics, and then I'm going to sing them two times. After which, you sing them four times with me. Here we go! So the honeybee dances on the tree, so we'll know how to find the pollen. So the honeybee dances on the tree, so we'll know how to... Everybody! So the honeybee dances on the tree, so we'll know how to find the pollen.
It's about time there's some more visual representation, I guess, than what things like YouTube can offer.
We don't want to take the time to put all the stuff up and set all the stuff up and just be playing all the time. So we just do it once, put it on film, ship it off somewhere and edit it, and it gets put on this little disc, and you can just pop it in your DVD player.
The eyes are a part of that process. Like, if your eyes are closed, you can't see anything. So when your eyes are open and you're watching things with a visual element, as opposed to with just like if you're listening, there's just sound. But when you're watching people who are playing music, then there is the visual element in which when you're watching, you're seeing something. And so the DVD will put images that are visual with sound.
This is actually a means of their expressing their connection to traditional influences by, you know, in a futile way, releasing a piece of art in an outmoded, outdated, and ignored format. Because by doing this and putting a lot of effort into something that will reach no one, it shows that they have succeeded.
I think the DVD is going to hopefully plant some visuals in the mind that need to be planted hard.
Well, I got about 25 of the Hello Kitty series. The same episode, I just can't stop buying that one.
I don't know if I've actually ever bought a DVD. I've been given DVDs.
I don't own DVDs. I hate physical media. I think a growing number of people just hate physical media. First of all, VHS, I could at least fast forward through, you know, the FBI warnings.
One thing I know about a DVD is that, sharpened appropriately, it's an excellent weapon. Excellent.
Before the CD, you had the record, more or less. And generally, you had like 20 minutes of music on one side of an album, which meant your album's like 40 minutes. And then suddenly the CD comes out, which only held 80 minutes. What were you thinking? Why don't you make it 90 minutes? Otherwise, you're going to have to like split all these double albums over two CDs, which is a total waste of time. And I feel like the DVD is the same thing.
And they get scratched, they suck, and I'm done with 480p.
Now that pretty much any physical media that's ever existed is able to be digitized, that's where their influence has come in terms of how it's digitized. They're them, they, we, your, he. I guess you missed that dang grammar school. They sell us these gadgets with the promise that now the power of the major movie studios and TV networks are in the hands of the consumers. And so we buy it up because we've always wanted that power. But what we don't realize is that all of those very organizations that these products claim to overthrow are the ones designing these products and how they function and how they work with each other. or how they don't work with each other. So we are forever trapped in a web of format incompatibility, while those powers that we claim to be able to overthrow with this technology continue pulling the strings. All of these decisions and these banal and seemingly innocuous details, when added up and considered, point to a large worldwide conspiracy. I'm not finished. Years of research, starting out with kind of wild speculation.
What were some of your first speculations?
Well, very few people realize that throughout the world, various individuals are invited to participate in these conventions, if you will, privately held, often somewhere in Europe, where various representatives from large multinational corporations, technology corporations, are sent to come to an agreement on a set of specifications for how consumer, prosumer, and professional-grade media equipment will operate.
But I'm sorry to interrupt, but that seems so banal. I mean, that, of course, you know, so what?
Right. Right.
There are these standards committees.
The Motion Picture Experts Group?
I think I'm a board member.
There are certain agendas in place to introduce a certain element of chaos into the standardizations and specifications and latent obsolescence and guaranteed incompatibility and control over compatibility geographically.
I think their true agenda is to propagate their own weak-willed, namby-pamby, mom-chinned ways.
Yeah, in as much as I can, you know, consider myself an expert in relation to the layperson and our relationship to whatever picture might be at hand, then yeah, there's a strong sense of superiority.
We first came into contact in the late 90s. They hired me as a consultant because of my expertise in moving pictures. Early on, there was a miscommunication because I had worked for a picture-moving company. So we got off to a rough start there. But once we sorted out our differences, they were able to look at not only the moving picture, but the big picture. And I helped them with that a lot. And they saw that I knew too much. Because I knew the big picture. And they are always trying to move it.
banana and the hand are perfectly made one for the other. And focusing much black too late. When you pull the tab, the contents don't squirt in your face. It absolutely does. You notice it has a point at the top for ease of entry. 40,000 nerve endings.
Hallo. Eine Klarba und Simana. Eine Tubada und eine Klarda Arlikanda. Kendo Salvanda. Only pounds of data. Slande Paula. Hesa. Siba. Siba. Haha. Siba. Iba. Ola. Kuntun von von. Alle der Klala. Ja. Sala. Akura. In the back of the Iba.
On the drum set. But really, folks, we like to call him Dudamus. Dudamus.
Dudamus.
Say it. It really bothers him. Dudamus. Say it. Dudamus.
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 Dudamus. Dudamus.
Say it again. Dudamus.
Dude.
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 Dude, did you ever wish that you could get a closer look at that book in Donnie Darko? And what was that crazy box in Mulholland Drive? What do they Might Be Giant songs mean? Who is the walrus? What does it all mean, man? Did you walk out of the Matrix scratching your head like me? Well, if I got the answer for you, dude, you need to check out Garth Samuelson's new book on Tate series. Dude, you just blew my mind. Unlocking the practical mind from the contemplative mind to the thinking soul, images serve as if they were contents of perception. You'll get 3 full hours of Gar's favorite tales of philosophizing, the quest for truth, the search for justice, what is reality? Judge the tree by its fruit, and do not meddle with the roots. Operators are standing by, and each one has a philosophy degree, so you can get into it, man. One of the most striking of
survival machine behaviors is its apparent purposiveness.
Gar changed my life. Gar blew my mind.
Here's how to order. COD and credit card customers call toll-free 1-800-555-DUDE. To avoid COD charges, just send $169.95 to Dude. You just blew my mind. PO Box 314159-26W, Elegant Whispers, Nevada 44074. You'll start with Volume 1. You'll be billed for a new volume every month forever. Call now for rush delivery. Satisfaction guaranteed or your money back. Not affiliated with 1-900-555-DUDE.
Put it on your Amex.
Around the world are thinking about starting their own California adventure. These people aren't us. These people are a plague. They are a disease, and I'm the cure. Now is the time to take a side, my friends. Will you help me to reclaim our California heritage? Or will you perish along with the half-breeds, perverts, and degenerates? The choice is yours. Join or perish.
Thank you very much. We are MirthCon from Oakland, California.
Because music is the best.
When you compare it to all other art forms, it pretty much dominates everything that's been done in the past and quashes all other attempts at human expression.
Manipulation of sound as an abstract thing is the kind of the zenith of our expressive potential.
It appeals to a lot of sensibilities.
You're walking down the street, you go this way, you go that way, bumping into people, seeing if they get upset, knocking their groceries over, you know, maybe stepping out in the traffic, you know, and seeing if cars screech to a halt. That's what music is to me.
I am a musician and a teacher of music and a failure at every other thing else I've ever done.
I needed to be a musician and needed to have music in my life all the time. It kind of took a priority over everything else.
It's ephemeral. There are a lot of ways to participate in it in time.
This is something that you're just kind of always hungry for. You don't even really have a choice. It'd be nicer to do something maybe easier, something you could take a break from. Music, it doesn't give you that chance. It's too huge for that.
All of the like visual elements or programmatic, like narrative, literary elements, those are all secondary.
I play, and I like to play fast, but I like good shit, you know. It's fast for fast sake, you know, whatever, you know. Musical masturbation, you know, finger diarrhea, whatever.
I certainly wouldn't be comfortable being like, look at me, this is the greatest thing ever. This is this profound, amazing music. Look at what an amazing player I am.
Liberace's energy is emanating through at least one fingertip in the band before any sound gets emitted. I spend quite a bit of time learning about traditional forms so that I can learn how to abstract them in appropriate places when necessary, or use them to appeal to audiences when I know that they would recognize them or make a relation to something, you know, some sort of historical thing on the drums. I really like history on the drums.
Music wasn't that huge a part of my life until I started doing music in school. I got that nasty little plastic Yamaha recorder in the little plastic bag, and I couldn't put it down. And because of that, I kind of thought, oh, clarinet's gonna be the exact same. Then my life just went downhill from there.
Piano for 3 years, I don't want to talk about that, and then trumpet for 4 in grade school, and I was terrible, and then I got braces, and I wanted to play sax, and I got a sax, and then the world kind of went, la.
Well, I think of the guitar as basically a percussion instrument. I think about striking it. I'm not really sure how many guitarists consider their instrument as a percussion instrument.
I mean, you think about decisions made in Congress recently, shifts in the markets, world social order. You pretty much listen to a Liberace song, it's gonna match most of his works.
I had to take piano lessons when I was very small, and I don't want to do this.
irrational. Don't lend themselves to numerology or fun alchemy or unified field theories interpreted concisely with jive seminae. Mostly regarding how the world's about to end.
Yes, we are bored. We're all bored now. But has it ever occurred to you, Wally, that the process that creates this boredom that we see in the world now may very well be a self-perpetuating, unconscious form of brainwashing created by a world totalitarian government based on money? And that all of this is much more dangerous than one thinks? And it's not just a question of individual survival, Wally, but that somebody who's bored is asleep, and somebody who's asleep will not say no?
Exactly.
people run from you, screaming in terror, asking for mercy. Those kind of things, a DVD is really good at eliciting.
They said it was one guy with a gun, and there was actually, you know, several different angles and trajectories and magic bullets that couldn't possibly have all come from one gun, but that's still the conclusion is there was one guy with one gun, and you think, what are you reading?
Well, we have to look at pictures and become experts at that.
That's about all I got.
What are you talking to me? I'm Cy Pistina, man. I used to sell carpets in New York. I was downtown Manhattan. I had a carpet store. It's beautiful.
Israel sending candy that was laced with aphrodisiacs into Palestine. I thought it was pretty entertaining. Because I don't even know what that would do to be subversive. It actually sounds pretty awesome.
Well, it was a slow going.
Bakersfield? I know it's a cultural mecca. Like the things that you want to do on a Saturday night, you can find them in Bakersfield.
It's great. I get a check. I still live in my rent control apartment. It's awesome. I dig it.
You're out.
Hoofing whippets in the gym.
Satellite television. I believe in it as much as I believe in the moon landing.
People who have facial hair actually have tattoos on their face that they're covering. So everybody who does sport facial hair, grab them and put them down on the ground and see what they're hiding, because they gotta be hiding something.
Well, you know, made me think of my dog.
Not really. I really had no idea what you guys were doing. I didn't realize it was going to be quite as ad libitum or whatever. I thought you guys had a, you know.